July the 22nd, 2013. And Prince George, like countless royal princes before him, is presented to the nation by his proud parents. This timeless scene is part of our national story.
He's a big boy, he's quite heavy.
Standing discreetly behind him is a black woman, their midwife, Jackie Dunkley Bent. Jackie and women like her have played a part in our story too, and this was their moment.
Thinking about that time in my life around the royal births, the midwives were very proud, and there were many midwives from BME extraction who talked about showing their children the television. In all honesty, I was overwhelmed by the impact that it had had on others.
Jackie and her colleague Erona Ahmed were following in the footsteps of thousands of Caribbean and African women whose contribution over the years has largely gone unnoticed.
Those days, people, when you put on this uniform and your hat and your apron and your belt, the people respected you for that. Oh, I couldn't part with this. This is history.
And yet, they have helped create and sustain the NHS for almost 70 years.
Without those nurses, we would not have the National Health Service we have now. There's no doubt in my mind that those of us who migrated into England, into the National Health Service, saved it.
They looked after us even at the expense of caring for their own families.
My children were always complaining that they never saw me. They never, you know, what is happening, Mum? Aren't these women going to stop having babies?
The nation has much to thank them for, but we haven't always shown it.
When I turned up on the doorstep, they didn't want me, herself and her husband. I don't want a black nurse coming into my house. I want my own midwife.
If you complained about me being black, there's nothing I can change about it. That's who I am, a black woman who happened to be a nurse, caring for you.
So yes. I don't know if any of this is familiar. It shows life at Musgrave in the 40s, 50s, 60s. So yes. Were you here in the 50s?
I was here in the late 50s.
And the Queen Mother came.
And I remember us forming a guard of honour for her. And you could see that we were wearing our yellow dresses and the white aprons with our caps on. And it is really a special day.
78-year-old Lynette Richards-Lord qualified as a nurse in 1962 at Musgrove Park Hospital in Somerset before going on to become a midwife.
We had our training schools. And I think the maternity wards were on the other side of the building, but these were all general wards. It was very hard work because you had 3 years of training, and your first year was you were like in sluice, bedpans. You were the bedpan queen. You made them shine and you cleaned them. That was your job. But when you became a second year nurse and you passed your first exams, that is when you started doing the interesting jobs.
That's Anita.
Oh,
she's from Guyana like me. Remember being in that group there. She was a good friend.
When I became a second-year nurse, I was supposed to graduate from the bedpans and start doing nice jobs. There was an English girl who was in my set, and she was doing these things, but I was still with the bedpans. And I mentioned the sister. She said, "Well, you know, your turn will come." So I didn't wait for my turn. I went to the matron and I said to her, "Matron, this is what is happening to me," and she said, "You leave it with me, Lynette. I will see to it." By the time I went back to the ward, things had changed.
And give me some of your nursing skills that you've imposed over the
years. Oh, I'm sure you can teach me a few things too.
All right. We'll teach each other then.
Yes, we will teach each other. It's a sort of very typical ward, what it was like.
Yes, Nightingale Ward.
Nightingale Ward, yes. Yes. And everything was had to be straight, you know. All the patients, they can't be lying on top of the bed, they have to be in the bed, that type of thing. You know, very, very, very sort of army style.
Annette's journey to Nightingale Wards had its roots in a time when the country needed help to repair the damage of war. Health Minister Annie Lynne Bevan wasn't shy of declaring his ambition for his new National Health Service in 1948.
I'm proud about the National Health Service. It's a piece of real socialism. It's a piece of real Christianity too, you know. And there is nowhere in any nation in the world, communist or capitalist, any health service to compare with.
But there just weren't enough doctors, nurses and midwives to run it.
The National Health Service at that time was straining again, as it is now, under the weight of what it needed to deliver. And there were not enough nurses. There were not enough nurses to do the job.
On July 5th, the new National Health Service starts, providing hospital and specialist services, medicines, drugs and appliances, care of the team.
Months into its launch, Bevan announced that the popularity of the service meant it was costing nearly 30% more than he had anticipated. The cost of prescription charges, dentistry and eye care was crippling the service and creating a staffing crisis. It was only a matter of time before the government would have to look beyond its borders for help.
Within the 12 months of the NHS being created, a report came out which identified there was a shortage, they needed about another 40,000 nurses and midwives. So really from 1949 onwards, there was actually a proactive campaign done by Department of Health and Minister of Labour, where they went out to the Caribbean and other parts of the Commonwealth to attract, recruit nurses.
We helped the mother country during war. We were now being called upon by the mother country to help them in another hour of need. This was not the war. This was care of the British public at time of illness.
Thousands of young women answered the call over the years, many with their own reasons for wanting to leave home.
I came here pursuing a nursing career. All I wanted ever was to be a nurse.
Zena Edmund Charles came to the UK from Jamaica in 1956, age 24, set on fulfilling her childhood dream.
At the age of 5, I told my teachers, family, friends, everybody, that I want to be a nurse, and I'm going to be a nurse. At the age of 16, my father, he was a minister, and he thought I was too scornful to do nursing, so he discouraged me from nursing. My mother was a seamstress, so he said, take your mother's trade or be a teacher. I wasn't interested in either.
This is my original uniform. It's something that is the most precious thing that I have. It's my pride and joy.
Beverly Chapman arrived in September 1969 as an 18-year-old with a burning sense of national pride.
I remember mainly one of the things that the lady said to me at the embassy. What do you feel about yourself as somebody that was born in Jamaica going to England? And I remember saying, I am an ambassador to Jamaica. I said that I will always put forward the best of Jamaica as I walk around England and nurse people.
In 1956, 18-year-old Jean Gay came to the UK to escape the cultural constraints of her life in Barbados.
God rest my mum, but I wasn't motivated to come to England because I was in this very strict home. You went to church most days of the week and then two or three times on Sundays and so on and so forth. And I just, you know, I wanted to go to pictures and I wanted to go to a party and to a dance and stuff like that. I had this ambition, I wanted to swear. It wasn't allowed in my mum's home. And so on. So when I got to England, the first things I was going to do was to swear at somebody.
In some cases, families helped save money, and in others, government bonds were purchased by the young would-be nurses and midwives to secure their passage to the mother country.
I came by boat. It was a 21-day voyage. The ship was called the SS Origas.
Others arrived by air. All were expecting an idealised version of England, influenced by Shakespeare, Bronte, and traditional country pursuits.
I remember being on this very nice train, and everything was grey, grey, very, very grey. It was sort of scary, but it was adventurous at the same time.
We ended up at King's Cross, and train stations in Jamaica are in the open air, and there you can see the sky, and you can see fields, and you can see cows and the odd sheep. This was this cathedral of steam or smoke. It was like something out of a novel. I was completely transfixed by the noise and the smell, and it was filthy.
I couldn't believe that I was in London. I thought it was the ugliest, the darkest, the most dismal place I had ever seen. My father had a brother in England. When I came to London, I had to get in touch with him. When I got to his house, they didn't have a bath. And I thought, no, this is England. Is this? And I realized it was normal. And I asked him, I said, where's your bath? Where do you all bathe? And he said, oh, well, we don't. We go once a week to Caledonia Road baths. And I thought, but this is my father's brother. He's a West Indian. How could he live and not bathe? This is something that's inherent in us. You bathe twice a day minimum in Trinidad, you know? And I thought, my God, he's really lived here a long time.
The women had little time to adjust before being sent to their training hospitals around the country. There, they would encounter long hours, low wages, and little sleep. For those who could stand the pace, it was the start of a lifetime working for the NHS.
When we started in the training, we used to go to a classroom, and we were taught the theory of nursing. And then they had another room where they called the practical room. We had dummies and you showed them how to wash patients and so on. We had things like what they call the pressure areas, show you how to rub the backs and rub the bottoms. And you're shown how to do the injections and that type of thing. And then after 3 months, you took an exam and you were sent to the wards. And that's when you were let loose to the patients, right? Poor patients.
By 1955, recruitment was still ongoing, despite tens of thousands of black nurses having arrived in the UK, the majority coming from the Caribbean. But there was a catch. It seemed not all NHS recruits were created equal. State-enrolled nurses sat a two-year course and were seen as practical support staff, as opposed to the state-registered nurses who trained for 3 years and were eligible for promotion to roles such as ward sister. Many black women, regardless of ability, were funneled into the junior SEN category right up until it was abolished in the mid-1980s.
There are also a lot of very negative cultural assumptions going on. There was an expectation that they would not be able to cope with a higher nursing qualification of a state registered nurse compared to the slightly lower one of a state enrolled nurse. And a lot of them ended up on the state enrolled nurse programme, which was an inferior qualification, didn't have international recognition, and they didn't realise until it was too late to opt out.
I felt like I was nothing. I was just a slave, just taken for granted. I feel low, very low, as if I was inferior. They make you feel like that. They didn't make you feel like that. And the funny thing, I'm a very outspoken person, but then I swallowed my pride because
outside of the workplace, life was proving just as difficult. The 1948 Nationality Act had granted all subjects of Crown colonies a legal right to live and work in the UK. But there was no law against prejudice.
They had a nuisance at work, they won't work. And for folks who got them living by them, they had a more nuisance still.
So I've got to bring this little boy up. Amongst them, and they're not clean, and the smell of the cooking makes you feel sick.
You can get them all out of the country, and as soon as you can get them out, the better I'll be pleased, I'll tell you that.
Although thousands from the Caribbean and Africa had been asked for help, the public and perhaps the government did not expect or want these economic migrants to stay more than a few years.
When people were first invited, it was very much on the idea that it'd be temporary. It wouldn't be that many. That was how it was sold. You're talking mid-50s, when it became, you know, as large numbers, you're talking 20,000, 30,000 a year, when it becomes clear that this is going to be people staying, it's going to be people bringing families. This is really when Keep Britain White emerges, when the more overt forms of racism emerge, because Britain never wanted us here. The British people never invited us here. The British state didn't really want us to stay here. It was just to fill a void.
On the streets and the pubs and the factories, the government did not communicate to white people that, by the way, we are inviting people from the Caribbean to work in key jobs. We need this labour. Please welcome them with open arms.
I didn't feel in any way strange when they started talking about immigrants coming in and taking their jobs in it, because I knew, one, it wasn't true. I knew that immigrants got the jobs that they didn't want to do. I've known that all along. They thought we would come in, run the buses, work at Lyons, do the nursing and all the other things that we did, and we would go home at night. And somehow, miraculously, wherever we came from, we would fly back in the following morning to continue our shifts. It wouldn't, how we lived in the interim was of no concern to them.
Some of the women who did want to return home with experience and qualifications under their belt found that they couldn't afford to.
It became apparent after a year or so that this plan is not going to work. Firstly, one wasn't saving any money. There wasn't enough to save. The wages were small. Our needs were met. We were fed and sheltered. But the actual cash you had in your hand at the end of a month would be £9 or £10. To get back by ear at the time, when I inquired, was £500. Our parents wouldn't have had that sort of money, having helped us to get to England. There was no money to bring us back home.
I felt out of sorts. And I remember calling my mum up, made a reverse charge call to Jamaica, and this long sob story. And she says, "You are a Tate. And Tates do not quit. Furthermore, you are 4,000 miles from Jamaica and there are no buses from Harrogate to Jamaica." You put the phone down. That was it. I had to shape up. There was no excuse. There was no, "I can't because." That's not how I was raised, and that's not how she expected me to perform.
As staying in the UK became a reality for more and more black people, far-right leaders were quick to exploit the government's failure to deal with the rising tension.
"Well, there are many immediate evils of the coloured invasion which are well known to everybody living in this area. But in our opinion, the most important is the long-term one of mass interbreeding. We feel that you cannot have coloured immigration on the scale in which you're having it today without sooner or later having mass interbreeding. That must lead..."
Nurses and midwives had to go to work every day against a backdrop of racial violence in the news.
I mean, 1958 is where you see the flashpoint, so the Notting Hill race riots, which actually, when we remember them, we kind of remember those as being related to black people. This was not black people, this was white races who ran around Notting Hill causing trouble, and that's kind of one of the first flashpoints you see. People were afraid to go out on the streets, and people were legitimately afraid, because you had things like the Teddy Boys roving around, you had people getting beaten. You can go through history and pick out periods where you can find there's lots of violence which was done to black people and black women as well as black men, where people were afraid and legitimately afraid to go out.
I had my own fight with Teddy Boys. I remember leaving work one night as I was coming out of the hospital, stopped in this shop and bought a portion of fish and chips, and there was this group of Teddy Boys. About 10 of them. They knocked the fish and chips out of my hand. I remember being pushed and kicked and so on. And then the beating swelled up in me. So I decided to ignore the blows. I was kicked in places I didn't know I possessed. And ignored the blows, and I just focused on one of them. And I remember poking my finger in his eye. And he swore, and they all ran after that. Even though it was all those years ago, it's something that is still, you know, I can still visualize it. It's quite horrible.
The big ones, yeah. Not all memories are so unhappy. Many black nurses and midwives were welcomed with open arms. Beverly and Linda remain friends to this day.
"Oh, goodness me. This is me with my afro. I had an afro perm for quite a few years, around about the time that the boys were born. And this is Bev and I at our best. On the dance floor, having a laugh. I think if Bev and I were up and looking like that dancing, they'd obviously put one of our songs on for us."
In 1970, Linda was a trainee nurse at St. James's Hospital, Leeds. It's where she would first meet a young girl from Jamaica.
So I'm walking down with my suitcase and my bag the very first moment, and there's this girl that came up to me and said, "Excuse me, where are you from?" And I said, "I'm from Jamaica." And I'm thinking, what is this? And she said, "Well, my name is Linda Rushworth, and I'm going to be your friend. And I'm going to look after you."
On the first day of the course, Bev looked so nervous and not sure where she was or what to do. And I just sort of saw her and thought, oh, do you know, I need to speak to this girl. I need to tell her that I'll be a friend.
I looked at her and I said, "You're going to look after me?" She said, "Yeah."
And we've just been friends ever since.
As trainee nurses, their shifts would see them spend little time together on the wards. But outside of work, their lives would revolve around each other for the next 40 years.
Linda is like my sister. Linda knows Montego Bay, Jamaica, like I do.
There are not many people you can say are true friends. She's supported me for 40-odd years.
Many black nurses and midwives found life easier when they gravitated toward the big cities.
Didn't see a black patient while I was in Somerset. Not one. It wasn't until I actually went to Birmingham. That is when... I actually see my own people, you know? It was so different.
Well, the first big surprise when I came here was that there were so many black people at the Whittington. It was famous for its Caribbean nurses, and they just seemed to come all the time. And so it was really nice. You felt like home from home.
We have a lot of togetherness. So as black nurses, we always try and do things together, like cook our native food together. So whoever come, I was in Kent, so whoever comes to London and brought something back, we'd share it.
For me, that comradeship was what it meant to be to us nursing. It wasn't the studying, it wasn't the books, it was the comradeship you had.
You know, we learned to enjoy ourselves in our own environment. And the more we did that, the less the external things bothered us. We started to really have fun. We started to have some fun, some real togetherness with our own kind.
Like any young person living away from home, having fun was just as high on the agenda as working hard.
Oh my, having a good time? Having a better time. It was a good time. The dancing, the fun.
The blue beat. Da 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 dum.
In those days, you went from house party to house party. And you tried to get at least 2 a month, if you could. It was black people's way of harmonizing their lives and talking and being together, knowing that work hard, play hard, and get on with life.
You still have shubin, and you go and sell, and when you come out, you might go under the 8 o'clock, when you come out, it's 5 o'clock a morning or 6 o'clock a morning, daylight. And you don't, because you're down there, you don't realize it's a daylight. Another say, you rent a spot, like you stand up one place, and it's a rub off all the wallpaper. But you enjoy it. You go out, you look forward to go out on a Saturday night and the cellar party. It was the best thing, man.
Very often, you would go out. You'd be, how can you say, you might be sidetracked. You might meet an interesting person that you didn't want to leave, and so on. And very often, when we got back, you know, the doors would be locked. If we knew we were going to be back late, then we would leave the windows open, come back and climb through the window in your bed, and I never got caught.
It was good fun, and nurses were always up for fun. Nurses had a lot of fun. And then they go back on duty and go serious and get on with it. And but they didn't say no to a party, ever.
That didn't mean they weren't set on getting ahead, though.
This is a picture of me as a nurse. It must be before I qualified, because I haven't got my blue uniform, my blue belt on. This is my belt. Now, when you've qualified, you get a silver buckle. So somebody like your husband or your parents would buy you a solid silver buckle. And this is what this is. Just look how ornate mine is. Those days, people, when you put on this uniform and your hat and your apron and your belt, the people respected you for that. Oh, I couldn't part with this. This is history. When I put it on, I transcended into something. I was so proud of the scholarship. I was so proud of my training. I was so proud of my patients and how they loved me and the way that I nursed, that when I finished at St. James's, I had to keep this one uniform. And so I've kept it all these years.
Beverly was one of the lucky ones, a state registered nurse who went on to qualify as a midwife.
My wish was to deliver a lady without her having a tear. So I wanted to do what I was taught, but with a bit more of me, because that's how I nurse. I nurse with a bit more of me. I never saw myself as like a black midwife. I saw myself as a midwife with a job to do, to look after these ladies that has had to go through 9 months of a pregnancy, not knowing whether that baby's okay. And everybody said, I've taken a picture, it's this, X-ray. No, it's at the back of your brain. I hope that everything is all right.
Hello, how are you? I've just come to examine you. When did you come in?
This morning.
For black women battling to get ahead, midwifery offered independence and a well-defined career path.
I'm not sticking out again. Let's move on, please.
Professionally, it made the nurse a clinician in her own right, and it could lead to senior roles in the profession.
I'm just going to listen to the baby's heart.
Many, many black nurses went on to do midwifery, and there were good at it, seriously skilled, remain so.
It was a big deal to get your midwifery under your belt. Was a really, really good thing to do, and to be able to, you know, deliver babies or, you know, be in the postnatal ward or antenatal ward and so on and so forth. But yes, it was a stepping stone. It opened the door to you becoming a health visitor. And at the time, you had your own caseload, you were able to make decisions about the patients that you were seeing and so on. So it was something that people aspired to.
You are considered a practitioner in your own right, so that you could, as long as you identify that a woman is normal and is likely to continue with a normal pregnancy, then you can, in effect, and by law, look after her entirely by yourself.
I'd like to say that I had a passion for women's health, I wanted to be a woman's advocate, but it was a natural progression from nursing to midwifery. Nobody told me what to do, I just felt that I would like to... I considered it to be a career progression.
It certainly worked for midwife Lynette. She went on to become a director of nursing, one of the first black women in the UK to reach that rank.
This is a register of cases. For any district midwife, she has to make a record of all the cases that she delivered. We delivered a baby at 9:15 p.m. This baby was 8 pounds, 12 ounces. And she had a normal delivery, normal labour, third stage complete, blood loss minimal, and both were satisfactory. So when we discharged them, everything was all right. Sometimes, on average, you had one delivery every other day. Sometimes, and you know, one night, I was called three times. As soon as I got in, another call came. The operator would say, there's a case there for you. And I would say, am I the only one on duty? He said, well, you know, you're the one who answers first. So I said, well, you should check the others, because, I mean, I need to have some sleep.
Others simply saw caring for expectant mothers and delivering children as their vocation.
I went into nursing as a means of bettering myself. And when I had the opportunity of doing a midwife, and I thought, well, yes, this is my calling.
When that baby pops up, I say, yeah! And you see what you got, you feel even more joy within you than you did when you get that pay pocket.
It was an amazing experience of being a midwife and the different types of women you met and the different types of labours and what they did when they were in labour, sing, hit their husbands, squeeze their hands to death or swear at them and say, you know, never again, you got me into this.
I delivered this baby and I was travelling on the bus like 38 years afterwards. And this lady tapped me on the shoulder and says, excuse me, are you Carmen? And I said, yes, but sorry, I don't recognize your face. And she said, you delivered my son. And then I said, you remember me from then? And she said, oh, yes, I'll never forget you.
I am proud to be a midwife. It's one thing I know that I have done well, that I know women have appreciated what I've done.
This commitment to the care of mothers was second to none, but it came at much personal cost to the midwives and their families.
Working as a midwife, some things had to be sacrificed. If I'm called out to someone who is perhaps not in labour, but she's uncomfortable or needs advice or whatever, I couldn't turn around and say, no, I'm not going. I had to be there.
My children were always complaining that they never saw me. They never, you know, what is happening, Mom? Aren't these women going to stop having babies? You're never here. But that was only because I had to do what I had to do at work, and I would stay behind, and I would make sure that everything was okay with these women. And I always, too, believed that, you know, if you did have a family and you have to have them on board, they have to understand what your job is about. If you're going to be, if you really enjoy it and you really love it, they have to understand why. And I remember once, after years of arguing and upset with my husband and the kids, he came to me one day and he said, Ali, I just had an aha moment. And I said, why? What about? What for? He said, I just realized that you're actually married to the job. And then me. He said, I could live with that. I could live with that. Yes, my husband actually said that to me.
For many black nurses, practically maintaining a better life for their children meant working long hours to earn enough money, but also covering the shifts that other nurses didn't want to do.
Any person that migrates, that comes thousands of miles, leaves from their home to come to a different country, comes for two reasons. One is for work and usually for their kids, because they want a better life for their kids. This is why you'll find immigrants generally will work very, very hard, will generally do jobs that nobody else wants to do, because it's very much an act. You don't just go thousands of miles for no reason. And so nurses are no different in that regard. And particularly if you look at the shifts, the amount of work, the labour that's involved in nursing. These people working very, very hard in major part to make better lives for their children.
We did have to do the night shift. But some of us used that to our advantage because some of us had children. And childcare at the time was non-existent. So it suited us. Once the authorities knew that how we lived, how we coped, there was this sort of unpleasant situation where people who had children then, they were forcing them to work days. I had negotiated a contract that where I work nights, and then I could look after my little ones during the day. You'd work these things out for yourself, and then you'd find the sand shifting from under your feet. So it is true, one way or another, we were always being challenged.
Glasses?
Yeah. Do you think we should get them from the box underneath?
Or... I'm glasses here.
Yeah.
This is going to be a nice wine, 2004.
Oh, is that a good year?
I think it's the right time to be drinking it more than it's a good year.
Jean and her husband were not unusual in having to ask their oldest child to look after younger siblings.
Oh, most times, Joseph would be at home. Sometimes we were in a tight place where we had to cross, where the shifts crossed, and we had to leave big child in charge. And fortunately for us, she was very disciplined.
Being the child of a nurse, it could be a bit difficult because there were times when I did think it wasn't fair that I might have liked to do what might be classed as a little bit naughty or a little bit reckless or a little bit, you know, but I wasn't able to because I had accepted the mantle of eldest child.
How did you feel having the responsibility when both of us are out?
I don't think I really resented it, but there were times, when I did think it really wasn't fair.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you recognise it as a responsibility?
I did. I really did.
Push down if you want to.
At work, black midwives were unwittingly paving the way for their community.
And again?
The intimate nature of the care they delivered took black nurses into white lives in an unprecedented way. Even though they had escaped some of the hard slog of nursing and found a
very, very, you know, upsetting when, as a human being, you're trying to help someone and she doesn't want you there because of your colour.
Feeling abandoned by society and with little faith in the system, some black families were compelled to take drastic action to ensure their children's well-being. One young nurse would make a brave but not uncommon decision.
I went into the nurse's home one day after work and there was this Beijing girl sitting at the bottom of the stairs crying. And I said to her, "What's the matter?" And she said she had gone, she'd got off work early. She'd gone to pick up her son from the childminders, only to find he was still sitting in the pushchair that she'd left him in the morning and still wearing the same nappy that he had been wearing when she left him. And This thing hurt and upset her so much, it left a lasting impression on me. And I think it was that reason that when I had my daughter, I decided there's no way I'm giving her to anybody here to look after. She will be much better off with my parents and my family in Barbados. It wasn't difficult for me to send my daughter back to Barbados because I knew she would be well looked after. I knew she would have friends, she'd have family, and I knew that my parents would care for her the way that I probably would not have been able to care for her if she'd stayed with me. I discussed it with her dad, and he didn't seem to think that there was going to be a problem. It affected my relationship with my daughter in a terrible way. Because when my mum did bring her back here to England, we had no relationship. She didn't really know who I was. When my mum went back to Barbados, she couldn't understand why her mother, as she thought, had left her here with me, this horrible woman. My husband and I thought at the time that because we wrote to her regularly, we spoke on the phone, we sent photographs of ourselves, we got photographs of her, and my parents explained that her mother was in England, that it was enough, but it wasn't. It wasn't enough. And it took her a long time to really understand why I took her to Barbados.
Has he just woken up? He looks very sleepy.
No, he hasn't actually.
Beatrice Norman is retiring as head nurse of children and young people at North Middlesex Hospital.
Are you being good? You are, aren't you? No.
After coming to England from Uganda in 1968, age 6, she would go on to forge an impressive career in paediatric nursing, championing the needs of her young patients, guiding the careers of her staff, and raising the standards of the departments she has worked in.
I love coming here because this is where we don't do anything painful. It's so nice, play, have fun, so the teenagers can hide in there and escape, and the little ones come in here and play. We have two fantastic play leaders.
However, Beatrice is still rare in rising to the top of her profession as a black woman.
There was a report came out there, the Snowy White Peaks, Roger Klein, 2014, and it says that the actual advancement of, so you've got lots of black staff in NHS, but the advancement is terrible. I mean, it's like 1% of chief executives, like 5% of senior managers. If you look at where people are still located in very particular roles within NHS, even now, 70 years later.
I feel very angry that 70 years have gone. And it tells me that if there was some other issues that had gone on for 70 years, that would not be tolerated. I mean, if, for example, you had white nurses who had stuck at their position for all these years, I think MPs would be shouting about it, you know? I just think it wouldn't be tolerated. It would be obviously so unjust.
I think we need to have that belief that actually we're just as good as the person next to you. You have to shine. You have to really show that people don't have a choice but to give you that job. You've got to be very determined. And you have to try and ignore those people that put blocks in the way. I'm passionate about caring for children. I'm passionate about them getting the right care.
Other black women have found it extremely difficult to advance to more senior roles.
When I started applying for sisters' posts, I was told, I thought I did well. And then when I said, why did I not get the job? Oh, you was only beaten by 1 point, 2 points, never more than 1 or 2 points. So therefore, in the end, I stopped applying. I said, I've been passed over so many times. And I said, I'm not going to make a fool of myself anymore.
It's a sad and painful story, common to many black women.
That, made me demotivated So there was a time I just didn't want to do any further calls or anything because I said, nobody is going to, you know, give me the grade I deserve, so why bother?
Gradually it dawned on us that it is not because I can't do a job that I'm not getting a promotion. It is because you don't like me.
I went off sick for a good 3 months because I was so stressed going in there. It's like you're fighting against people and you don't want to be the one to say they are prejudiced. But you know in the back of your mind, you know they are prejudiced and they're working against you. It makes you so hungry sometimes that you don't feel like going into work.
A lot of nurses gave up their career rather than endure it. A lot left the NHS.
There is a feeling about what good looks like. The lighter your skin and, you know, less melanin you have in your skin, the better your life chances will be generally across the board. And my suspicion is that that thinking was exactly what was going on for a lot of people who were in positions who could actually appoint people. Good looks like me. So me being white middle class male, white middle class female. So I feel safe, I feel comfortable, I know how they're going to perform, I know their background, so I'm going to choose them. I think the issue lies within the system, and the system has been developed in a way that makes black and ethnic minority people in the system struggle.
The reaction from staff as Beatrice's retirement looms is evidence of what the NHS will lose if it fails to value its black nurses and midwives.
I'm going to be very sad to leave my nurses. A lot of them have grown up with me. I'm quite passionate about them.
Magda, are you going to eat something?
Yeah.
It's been a long, long journey. It's time for someone else to take over. I'm leaving people I really care for. So I've been very lucky. I've been blessed to work with such a group of people that I really, truly love. So that doesn't happen very often.
You know how I feel about you leaving, so, you know,
cross.
You've been a very, yeah, I'm very cross and mad. but, you know, it's time for you to go, and we all have to respect that. You know, there's always a place for you. If you need anything, just come by, call.
Thank you. This is always going to be my family.
I've worked really hard to build up that service, and it's a fantastic service. It's very well known. A lot of the paediatricians have come back as consultants because of what the service is. So I'm very proud to have been part of that.
The contribution of black health workers, men as well as women, is a story of achievement over adversity. 2 years after her first royal birth, and part of a legacy of black women who braved the hostility to care for a nation, Jackie Dunkley Bent was once again the top choice to lead the team who would safely deliver Princess Charlotte into the world.
I'm a great believer in, you know, putting your head down, working hard, being wise, knowing the system, and knowing how to place yourself within that. I personally don't think that my success is down to the era that I was born. I think that, you know, that there were people that were successful decades before me. And I think that there is something innate in people that enables them to either not see the barriers and the challenges, or even if they see them, that they go right through them or go around them.
I think without us black people, they would have fallen so short that I don't think they would have survived.
Without those nurses, we would not have the National Health Service we have now. There's no doubt in my mind that
those of us who migrated into England, into the National Health Service, saved it.
In the summer of 2016, some of those whose stories we have heard gathered for an event to mark the life of the earliest known black woman to nurse British patients, a pioneer whose achievements have only recently appeared in school history books.
This statue will stand as a living testament to the life work of Mary Seacole, and as an ongoing tribute to the thousands of healthcare workers from the Caribbean and from Africa who underpin the modern NHS.
Born in Kingston, Jamaica in 1805, Mary Seacole was the first black nurse to come to the aid of the mother country as she cared for wounded British soldiers during the Crimean War.
So I think it's a very wonderful day, isn't it? To see one of us is being recognized through Mary Seacole. She nearly gave her life for this. And for us to now receive her legacy, I think it's a wonderful day.
It's really good to be alive. I know we've all made a contribution, but for her, it must have been even harder, and we are very proud.
Mary Seacole represents determination, dignity, persistence. Her determination in some ways reflects some of what we as nurses in the NHS had to go through. We wanted to help people, whether it was one person or a thousand people. And our professionalism was the platform on which we did it. We love nursing and we save lives.
And the legacy lives on. Zena, who left Jamaica to work here in 1956, is proud and undaunted after 50 years blazing a trail for black health workers.
India and Asia are my great-grandchildren. I brought them along with me so that they can learn what it is to be good, to be kind, to be helpful. Mary Seacole set an example for people like me, and bringing them here is setting an example for them as well. I always say to my colleagues that you'll be able to cope, and I try my utmost not to get too depressed of things and try to be happy and cheerful and show my colleagues, black colleagues, that we can make it. We are here for a purpose. We can make it, and we will make it.